Today, Black Shalom L'Chaim, purified drink water. They got it. It's out there. This next video is the Roman invasion. I want to just call it the Roman invasion, but it's like the Roman invasion of Nubia, Kemetic, the Nubian Kemetic region, and yeah, that's what it is. So it's the invasion. Cue the music. I like.
Spend it all on shit that a throne won't weigh each part. We'll build that house up big and tall. We'll break the bank to build the world. We're robbing Peter to pay Paul. As long as last they come to mind.
American friend keeps
blurring my vision.
Romans fought many wars across the realms of antiquity, with the most prominent of these being featured over and over again in mainstream documentaries. However, there are many forgotten wars that are just as fascinating and well worth exploring. They introduce us to overlooked cultures, and especially make us question just why these wars were forgotten in the first place. In this video, we'll be exploring the Roman invasion of Kush, the kingdom beyond Egypt, which had claimed the head of Augustus. Let's begin by examining the Kingdom of Kush. Located in modern Sudan, it was a region with a rich history dating back thousands of years, virtually to the birth of human civilization itself. As with its neighbor to the north, much of its development would be driven by the life-giving presence of the Nile. Geographically speaking, the Nile starts narrow and winding as it meanders its way over hard rock, forming a series of cataracts before eventually straightening out and widening as it eventually fans out into a delta that merges with the Mediterranean. The differences between these various stretches of river would have huge implications for the early civilizations that sprouted roots along its banks. In Lower Egypt, for instance, the river routinely overflows into a wide floodplain that makes irrigation easy. At the same time, wide, flat stretches of the Nile with north-flowing currents but south-blowing winds made travel easy. This supercharged the agriculture and trade of early Egypt, propelling its first dynasties to great heights. Upper Egypt too benefited from these geographic boons, though perhaps to a slightly lesser extent. However, once one hit the first cataract, things began to change. The narrower Nile had a much reduced or non-existent floodplain, while the winds blew less favorably and rapids or waterfalls made continuous waterborne travel difficult. The potential for agriculture and trade were therefore diminished, and a natural break occurred between the lands of the north and south. Yet that isn't to say they were completely separate. In fact, their histories were long intertwined. While Egypt of the 3000s BC was first united in the early dynastic period, the lands of Nubia played host to a variety of tribal kingdoms. Chief among these was the Kingdom of Kerma, which eventually gained control of the vast lands extending from the first to the fourth cataracts. It appears to have been a highly centralized state which drew wealth from agriculture, pastoralism, animal products, mineral processing, and trade with the African interior. They were a force to be reckoned with, boasting a formidable army of footmen, skirmishers, chariots, and at times even elephants, which frequently clashed with their neighbors. But it was their archers in particular, armed with massive 2-meter bows and cane arrows, that gained a fearsome reputation across antiquity. The Egyptians knew this well, referring to their southern neighbor as Ta Seti, or the land of the bow, and making frequent use of Nubian archers as auxiliaries and mercenaries. The later Achaemenids would also recognize their prowess and drafted them into their imperial army. Thus we see that these lands of the southern Nile were not to be overlooked. Generations of northern pharaohs had to respect the threat from Nubia, which would raid or invade their lands during times of weakness. But the relationship cut both ways, and when Egypt was strong, it would be the one to push the offensive beyond the first cataract. It is these ebbs and flows in history that would over time mix the cultures of these two regions that were otherwise geographically distinct. For instance, in the 1900s BC, Middle Kingdom Egypt extended its boundary south to the Second Cataract to establish new trading outposts and mining operations. We hear of many border wars and raids during this era, while also seeing a substantial uptick in the development of heavily fortified towns along the contested frontier. Later, in the 1500s BC, the unparalleled supremacy of New Kingdom Egypt would see it push all the way to the Fourth Cataract, swallowing virtually the whole of the Kingdom of Kurma, but leaving much of the heartland regions further south untouched. During these key centuries of direct pharaonic rule, new cities and temples were built, while the local ruling class adopted many aspects of Egyptian culture, including their architecture, religion, language, and writing. Following the fall of the New Kingdom, though, Nubian rulers would return to the helm as the Kingdom of Kush centered around Napata. Its kings slowly gained wealth and power and came to see themselves as the true guardians of the Nile. Thus, when the northern pharaohs once again fell into a state of collapse, the kings of Kush pushed north. They first solidified their hold on Lower Nubia before taking Upper Egypt and eventually challenging the princes of Lower Egypt. Finally, following the hard campaigning of King Piye, the entirety of Egypt would belong to the Nubians, forging one of the largest territorial powers of its day. Yet they were not seen as some occupying force of alien outsiders. The ways of the Nubian rulers were quite familiar to the Egyptians, and the heirs of King Piye ruled as the official 25th dynasty. As a testament to their legitimacy, they wore the traditional double crown of Upper and Lower Egypt, worshipped Egyptian gods, had their names inscribed in the official records and temples, and by most accounts were seen as fair, benevolent rulers who did much for the people. Eventually, however, their fortunes also waned in the face of the rising Neo-Assyrians that launched several invasions against the Levant and Africa. After many bloody bouts, the kings of Kush were eventually forced to pull back to their traditional lands of Nubia. Yet they still kept a substantial sphere of influence over the lands of Egypt through trade, diplomacy, and of course, war making. The resurgent powers of Egypt, though, grew tired of this interference, launching fresh offensives that managed to sack the capital at Napata in 529 BC. As a result, King Aspelta would move his administrative center to the more southern city of Meroe. From here, the Kushites would rebuild themselves. They would do so in a slightly different environment than before. The lands around Meroe were far from the lush floodplains of the Nile, but that did not doom them. Agriculture here instead drew life from tropical rainfall. Productive farming could therefore still take place, but required new practices and the use of more sophisticated tools. At the same time, there were also plentiful lands to graze vast herds of cattle, while rich mineral deposits made for the lucrative extraction of copper, iron, and gold. Meanwhile, the adoption of dromedaries vastly expanded trade routes through the region, while merchants increasingly tapped into the shipping lanes along the Red Sea. The Kingdom of Kush was thriving. As proof of this, when the Achaemenid Empire conquered Egypt in the 520s BC, Cambyses would send spies to assess the strength of the southern lands. Herodotus reports that when the King of Kush discovered these men, he replied by sending back a bow with the simple message, quote, "When the Persians can draw a bow of this greatness as I do, only then should they bring overwhelming odds to attack the long-lived Ethiopians. But till then, they should thank the gods for not giving the sons of the Ethiopians a mind to win more territory than they currently have." Apparently, this enraged Cambyses, who sent a force of over 50,000 to confront them. However, his campaign would ultimately end in disaster when supplies ran out and a huge contingent of the army was swallowed in a sandstorm. Eventually, though, some advances may have been made by his successors, as it seems the area between the First and Second Cataract were part of the Ethiopian satrapy listed by Herodotus, while Nubian rulers were said to send regular gifts to the King of Kings. Over the following centuries, though, the heartland of the Kingdom of Kush at Meroe would remain unconquered and rose to new heights. As it did so, the local culture slowly came into its own, melding with and superseding the previous Egyptian-dominated one. We see this in the addition of new religious sites and deities such as the lion god Epitomek, as well as with new styles of art, architecture, government, and language. It was all a fascinating mix that we sadly don't know enough about and can only really begin to scratch the surface on in this video. Suffice to say, the Kingdom of Kush was no mere backwater territory. By the first century BC, it was a power on the rise, ready to march out and expand its reach up to the First Cataract and beyond. This would put them on a collision course with Rome. But let's first rewind a bit here to see how the Romans even came into the picture in the first place. While the Nubian kings and queens had been undertaking their millennia-long struggles back and forth across the Nile against Egypt, Rome had been born and was expanding its way across the Mediterranean in what, by comparison, must have seemed like the blink of an eye. By the 1st century BC, the Italian power had become involved in Egypt over the course of the civil war, which saw Pompey flee the country and a pursuing Caesar get involved in the ongoing civil war. In the aftermath, Rome would find itself backing the Ptolemaic rule of Cleopatra, who in turn supported Mark Antony in his contest against Octavian. When the pair lost the Battle of Actium in 31 BC, a victorious Octavian finally established control over the whole Roman Empire. In the process, he would annex the lands of Egypt and begin to impose a new administrative regime. Cornelius Gallus was appointed as the province's first prefect. He set to work restoring order by revamping programs like the local police force, dealing with fractious tribes, and putting down a revolt in Thebes. Further military expansion brought Upper Egypt under Roman control and also led to the establishment of a protectorate in the border area around the First Cataract. However, his ambitions drew the ire of Augustus, who had him removed and replaced by the more amenable Iulius Gallus. This new prefect would now be given orders from the emperor to undertake fresh campaigns in his name that would bring gold and glory to the empire. According to the historian Strabo, the targets would be Arabia and Ethiopia. We previously covered the first of these campaigns in another video, which featured an invasion force of some 10,000 men and 130 ships. Its departure weakened Egypt's defenses, which now emboldened the Kingdom of Kush. Its current ruler was a kandake, or queen, by the name of Amenerenus, whom Strabo describes as, quote, a masculine sort of woman, blind in one eye. We know little of her rule, but from the few descriptions that remain and her following actions, it seemed that she had a fierce reputation with bold, militaristic ambitions. Around 25 BC, Amenerenus launched an expedition with some 30,000 troops against the Romans. These surged past the First Cataract, invading the region of the Thebais and attacking the three cohorts stationed there. The Cushites took Philae, then Syene, and Elephantine. The inhabitants were enslaved, the surrounding lands raided, and a statue of Augustus was even pulled down, its head reportedly being later discovered by archaeologists at the site of Meroe in 1910 under the ceremonial path which led to the Altar of Victory. Such humiliation could not be tolerated, and Rome soon prepared to respond. The disgraced prefect, Iulius Gallus, had been recalled by Augustus, and it would now be up to Gaius Petronius to take action. His punitive campaign called for the mustering of 10,000 foot and 800 horse, likely made up of two local legions, the 3rd Cyrenaica and the 22nd Deo Tariana. In 24 BC, these now set out for vengeance. After several weeks, they had finally advanced to the lands of Upper Egypt and confronted the lingering remnants of the 30,000 strong army of Queen Amenerenus. The Romans here seemed to have had the upper hand whilst operating alongside the navigable portions of the Nile, and the Cushites justifiably pulled back behind the First Cataract to regroup at the city of Selcis. From here, a brief stalemate ensued as ambassadors were exchanged. I'll now pass you on to Strabo for the story. Quote, Petronius sent ambassadors to demand what they had taken, as also to ask the reasons why they had begun war. And when they said that they had been wronged by the nomarchs, he replied that these were not the rulers of the country, but Caesar. And when they requested 3 days for deliberation, but did nothing that they should have done, he made an attack and forced them to come forth to battle. Petronius quickly turned them to flight, since they were badly marshaled and badly armed, for they had large, oblong shields, and those too made of raw oxhide. And as weapons, some had only axes, others pikes, and others swords. Now, some were driven together into the city, others fled into the desert, and others found refuge on a neighboring island, having waded into the channel, for on account of the current, the crocodiles were not numerous there. Among these fugitives were the generals of Queen Amenerenus. These One and all he captured alive, having sailed after them in both rafts and ships. And he sent them forthwith down to Alexandria. And then he also attacked Selkis and captured it. And if the multitude of those who fell in battle be added to the number of the captives, those who escaped must have been altogether few in number. From Selkis, he went to Premnus, a fortified city, after passing through the sand dunes where the army of Cambyses was overwhelmed when a windstorm struck them, and having made an attack, he took the fortress at the first onset. After this, he set out for Napata. This was the royal residence of Amanerenus, and her son was there. But though she sent ambassadors to treat for friendship and offered to give back the captives and the statues brought from Syene, Petronius attacked and captured Napata too, from which her son had fled, and razed it to the ground. And having enslaved its inhabitants, he turned back again with the booty, having decided that the regions further on would be hard to traverse. Yet while Petronius may have recovered Roman honor with this expedition, he had done little to actually weaken the strength of the Cushites, whose lands around Meroe remained untouched. In fact, it seems that their invasion may have actually helped Queen Amenorenus rally the locals to her side. This was a threat identified by Petronius, who made sure to establish a check against the enemy upstream of the first cataract. At the cliffside fortress of Premnus, overlooking the Nile, he set up a force of 400 men with enough supplies to hold out for 2 years. Satisfied, he then set off back to Alexandria. Once there, he delighted in his victory, selling off loot and captives, and even sending 1,000 prisoners of war to Augustus. However, Queen Amenorenus remained undeterred, and now marched back with a new force of many thousands of men to re-establish control of the lands to the north. Word got back to Petronius of her advance, and a race was underway for the fortress of Premnus. Luckily, the Romans got there first. New troops reinforced the garrison and set about bolstering its fortifications. Their position proved so strong that it was enough to force the enemy to halt before its gates. Queen Amenorenus perhaps considered an assault, but resisted. She had shown her people that she was a strong ruler and convinced the Romans that she would not be ignored. This was enough of a geopolitical win for her to now send ambassadors. As a sign of the leverage she held, these were not dismissed outright by Petronius, but were actually sent ahead and given an escort to bring them all the way to Emperor Augustus himself, who was in Samos. Once there, they were given an audience and treated quite favorably. Strabo tells us that Augustus granted them everything they wished for and even revoked the tributes which had previously been imposed upon them. These were extremely favorable terms. But why would Rome offer them? Well, it seems that some of this had to do with short-term considerations by Augustus, who wished to conclude a peace while otherwise dealing with a delicate situation in neighboring Parthia. There were also the more long-term considerations, where Rome realized it would have a quite difficult time exerting control beyond the first cataract. As we mentioned, lands to the south had less agricultural yield and were difficult to traverse by boat. Militarily, there was also not much the Romans could do in lands that quickly thinned out into desert or were host to all kinds of tropical diseases which could decimate an army that stayed too long. In the end, it proved best for both powers on either side of the Nile to settle into the usual balance of power that had existed for thousands of years. The peace which followed proved prosperous to both, and the Kingdom of Kush would rise to new heights as a valuable economic partner in the region. In fact, the cooperation developed to such a degree that when Nero later sent an expedition to find the source of the Nile, the King of Meroe would assist them in their journey that perhaps led them as far as modern Ethiopia and Uganda.